Hi everybody, I'm Jimmy from Dinosaurs Will Always Be Awesome, and welcome to September. If you haven't seen the rest of this year's Paleo Rewind, you can bask in awe at my friend Alex from PaleoGeek's awesome August video with the jump, which is right here. On the first day of the month, we're gonna start small. Camouflaging insects like the peppered moth have been presented for decades as examples of evolution in progress. Animals adapting to their environment slowly over time to increase their chances of survival. But when did these bougie bugs first learn this trick? Well, that's a discovery that we made this month. The earliest known fossil evidence of an insect mimicking a lichen. This tells us these insects made their habitats among trees and hid in and around this existing symbiotic relationship to increase their chances. On September 16th, Christie's Auction House and the Black Hills Institute for Geological Research issued a press release announcing that specimen BHI-3033, also known as Stan the Tyrannosaurus Rex, would be sold at auction as a result of a court case. It was a big deal. I even started a GoFundMe to try and buy the specimen back for the public.
James Hislop's bidder for $27,500,000. And sold. Thank you very much.
We didn't get it. You're gonna wanna tune in to Ben G. Thomas's October video for more on that story and its long-reaching implications for science. The next day, however, Pete Larson of the Black Hills Institute released a paper refuting the claims of a monumental study that had dropped on New Year's Day. The study, by Dr. Holly Woodard and her team, used the techniques of histology, examination of hair-thin slivers of dinosaur bone to study growth rates. The study indicated that the long-time identity crisis between T-Rex and Nanotyrannus could finally be laid to rest. I recently interviewed Dr. Holly Woodard about this specific study, and here's what she had to say about Nano versus T-Rex.
That argument stems from back in the 40s, an isolated skull with no postcranium, no skeleton along with it, was found in the Hell Creek Formation in Montana. It was a fairly small skull. I think it's a little over 3 feet in length. Since then, lots of people have studied it. In the early 2000s, Jane was found. It had a skull and a skeleton. So now we know that Jane and Petey and that isolated skull are juveniles of something. And science works through parsimony, which means the simplest explanation is the easiest to test. You could say that these are juveniles of a new species, that Nanotyrannus would actually have gotten bigger had it continued to grow, but that's really way more complicated than saying, we know T-Rex was around, we don't have any juvenile T-Rex, but Jane and Petey and this other skull are probably juvenile T-Rex. So that's not to say that Nanotyrannus, one day we could find evidence for it, but right now the evidence is that Nanotyrannus can be synonymized into T-Rex. But that's the cool thing, it only takes one adult specimen of a Jane-sized tyrannosaur to say, hey, we have a Nanotyrannus. So it can always be, tested, and my hypothesis could be rejected, but it takes evidence to test and then reject.
Larson's ongoing support for Nanotyrannus licensis is fueled by a few key points: the different number of tooth positions, specific skull features that aren't visible on the T-Rex specimens we've discovered so far, and the length of arm bones at certain stages of development. But based on the study that Dr. Woodard led, the objective was to establish that dinosaurs known as Nanotyrannus are currently juveniles, and whether they grow up into T-Rex or something else entirely is a different discussion that needs a larger sample size. For this next story, we have to go back a little bit.
Dateline, London. A scientific explorer has made a startling discovery of a feather embedded in stone. The ancient relic, now under lock and key at the museum, shall be studied to learn from this wondrous new creature known to science. What is known, however, is that it is definitely not from an Archaeopteryx. Certainly not. Not at all, boy howdy.
At the University of South Florida in Tampa, a new study provides substantial evidence that the first fossil feather ever discovered does in fact belong to the iconic bird-like dinosaur, Archaeopteryx. The debate's been raging on for the past 159 years as to whether or not this feather belonged to Archaeopteryx or some other unknown birdosaur, but new modern methods have shed a new light on its unflappable origins. This study, led off by Ryan Carney, who is an assistant professor of integrative biology at USF, debunks a long-standing hypothesis that the fossil feather originated from a different species entirely. Using an electron microscope, they were able to see microscopic pigment structures called melanosomes, which indicate not only that the feather was completely matte black, like the feather of crows, but it came from the left wing! Which was more dramatic when I read it the first time. Mosasaurs captured the imagination of moviegoers in Jurassic World, and a new member of the family made its big splash this September. Nathomortis stadmani. Stadman's Jaws of Death was a colossal marine reptile that swam the depths of Cretaceous, Colorado about 80 million years ago. These fossils were first discovered in 1975 and attributed to a different genus and species. But as our technologies improved, along with the growth of the amazing new field of paleogenomics, genetic research by Utah State University paleontologist Joshua Lively revealed that these fossils were actually not closely related to the samples of the Prognathodon species. Time for a new name. The super casual name of Jaws of Death is surprisingly appropriate given the immense 4-foot-long jaws and massive jaw muscles that gave it a formidable bite force. Speaking of reasons to never combine swimming and time travel, the Kemkem River system, which flowed through the Sahara Desert 100 million years ago, has revealed some new waterlogged wonders. Now, you've probably seen the glow-up that Spinosaurus aegypticus got in 2020, but what evidence do we have to support this? Published this month, an analysis of over 1,200 teeth found in these ancient riverbeds with distinctive surfaces and smooth cross-sections established that Spinosaurus probably spent more of its time in the river than along the riverbanks. Now, not every tooth out of the 1,200 recovered were spinos, but they included sawfish, coelacanths, crocodiles, and flying reptiles. These were all creatures that would have lived in or around the rivers of Mesozoic Morocco. Now, the study by Thomas Beaver and Aaron Quigley has to be seen to be believed. And thankfully, you can do both with the links in the description. No review of 2020 is complete without some earth-shattering revelation of a doomsday event, and that's exactly what September has to offer. Across the 4.5 billion year journey of life on Earth, we've discovered several disturbances in our fossil record. Geologic evidence reveals punctuated instances when global plant and animal populations died off suddenly, leaving their critical ecological jobs open and bringing forth the evolution of an entire new episode of biodiversity. When life on Earth goes extinct in such a massive event, we call it a mass extinction event. Geologists and paleontologists generally agree that these mass extinctions have occurred 5 times throughout history. Now, extinction is nothing new. Natural selection has led to the growth or noth of species since life began, but it's a big deal when the roster of living things is wiped out across the board. Bye-bye biodiversity. The first clearly defined extinction was 440 million years ago, when volcano-induced global warming and anoxia, which is the depletion of oxygen, ended the Ordovician period and ushered in the Silurian. Second was the Devonian extinction. Then, the Permian-Triassic extinction, in which 95% of all life on Earth vanished, including the mammal-like reptiles, the cynodonts, and the sailback Dimetrodon. Changing conditions drove the dinosaurs to diversify and grow massive between the Triassic and Jurassic extinction 210 million years ago. And then, the most famous extinction event of all time, so far. The Cretaceous Tertiary extinction, when the Chicxulub meteor impact in the Yucatan Peninsula ended the reign of the dinosaurs. Each extinction was a visceral, violent, or at least a very, very rough occurrence, and each one irrevocably changed the Earth forever each time. We called these the Big Five, until this year when we rediscovered number 6. The Carnian Pluvial episode was a major global climate change event, which saw drops in oxygen and the extinction of many keystone organisms, like bryozoa and crinoids and ammonoids. With these creatures dying off, their predators struggled for survival in the warming seas. The first known dinosaurs, like Eoraptor of Argentina, began to emerge after this event. The CPE helped clear the path for the oncoming explosion of the most enormous, diverse, and awe-inspiring animal clades in our planet's history. So why haven't we found it before now? Well, it turns out paleobiologists first identified a biological change around the time of the CPE in the 1960s. But it's been difficult to identify this event at a mass extinction level for two reasons. One, a lack of confidence in our dating processes and the correlation between marine and terrestrial sediments, and the fact that the CPE was tucked in between two other massive events. It's been hiding in plain sight until our methods and technology caught up. And this September, we made it official. Welcome to the club, global warming doomsday scenario number 6. Well, we've certainly seen a lot of exciting updates for 2020, and we're not done yet. Be sure to check out Benji Thomas's October Odyssey and catch up on the rest of the Paleo Rewind, as well as all of my references in the links below. And remember, no matter what you do, where you're from, or how old you are, dinosaurs will always be awesome.